New Testament reading today is Hebrews 12, verses 5 through 10. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure the chastening that God deals with you, as with sons, for what son is there from whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for the few days chastened us as they seemed best to them, but he for our own good, that we may be partakers in his holiness. May my words be pleasing to you, Father. Really quick, that first scripture we read from Ezekiel was a very impactful scripture on my life. We all know what this is, that we must read this constantly and daily. And if you don't mind, Evelyn, I'm going to put you on the spot for a second. Can you just go to Ezekiel and tell me if what you heard was correct? That's okay, because that's actually not even a Bible, so you're not going to find it in there.
Nothing's in here.
So you could give that back to me. But I kind of used to believe it was a Bible, right?
Yes, you did.
Yes, I did. So I kind of misled you. This is actually a book of fossils and invertebrates that I got out of Reverend Chuck's office. We're very easily deceived. And likewise, that really nice sounding scripture that we read from the book of Ezekiel is actually fictitious. It was from a movie called Pulp Fiction in 1992. And for 11 years, I actually believed that that was a really awesome Bible verse. And I called myself a Christian. But it's completely fictitious. It doesn't appear anywhere in the Bible. If you were to read Ezekiel 17, it just simply says, "You will know that my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon you." Nothing about brothers keepers. Nothing about sheltering, shepherding the weak. It all sounds really good, but it's just not true. This happens every day in our lives, both within the confines of Christianity and both within the outside world that we see every day. We're duped every day. We need to pay attention. We need to be our own people, the people that God created us, to make our own judgments based on what we see, and not from a collection of things people have just told us. It's fine to question things. I've read the word many times when I was reading and come across things that seemed contradictory or seemed like I didn't understand. This is okay. This is not anything to be ashamed of. We need to question things. We need to question what our eyes see. We need to question the actions of others. That doesn't mean that we judge. That does not mean that we judge someone else. But it means that we pay attention. Paying attention is the most important thing that we can do. We hear numerous references from the Old Testament and the New over and over again. Be diligent, be steadfast, be ever watchful. You will not know the day or the hour. Be at the ready. All the time that appears in the Bible. See, being good takes effort. It's kind of like when you go scuba diving and you have to breathe underwater, you need to think about it. It's not an effort. Being good takes an active effort. Because when you let your guard down, you simply become a jerk. There's no way to put it. You have to concentrate and make yourself do the right thing. Know to do the right. We can know it in our hearts, but to act it out. Just last week, I was in a supermarket, And there was a young lady in front of me. And in fairness, you know, even, sorry, my wife is sitting right here. She was very attractive. And she had a young 2-year-old about in her cart. And I just happened to see her putting her groceries up, and she had 2 orders. One she was paying with her WIC card, you know, the money that she gets from assistance, and the other were items that she had to pay for herself. And she was putting some items back because she couldn't afford the rest of the items. Everything in here screamed, just swipe your card on her order. But then what happens is the dupe comes in, and you hear that little voice. Well, you don't want to embarrass her. She's going to think you're hitting on her. You're going to go home and tell your wife you paid $57 for this pretty girl's groceries. How you know, explain. And then I didn't do it. And she walked away. And I had it. I did. I'm blessed. Those are the things that we have to pay attention to. Those are the things that take the focus off of Jesus, which is what the devil, the enemy, Satan, whatever you want to name him, wants us to do. Anything that takes the focus off of the work of Jesus Christ. And please forgive my little notebook. This is your assurance that you won't be getting out of here at 12 o'clock today. It kind of keeps me going. In keeping with the Hollywood theme, when I was a young man, and I didn't understand it then, there was a movie that came out that was called The Karate Kid. Has anybody seen The Karate Kid by any chance? Well, for those of you who've seen it, for those of you who hasn't, I'll make this as quick as possible. But young Daniel LaRusso is a boy that's being bullied by a bunch of karate guys, and he happens to fall upon Mr. Miyagi, who ends up teaching him the ways of martial arts. But he doesn't do it in a conventional fashion in which we say, oh, meet me here at 5 o'clock and we'll have an hour-long lesson. He hands him 2 round sanders and says, I need you to sand the floor, and you have to do it this way. And when he thinks he's done, Mr. Miyagi takes him in the backyard, and the floor just goes on and on and on for like 5 miles. And he has to sand this entire floor. And it's midnight, and Daniel goes home. And then the next day he comes in, he's ready for his karate lesson. And Mr. Miyagi is, you gotta wax all of these cars. There's like 100 cars in the parking lot. But you have to wax it like this, and you have to wax it like this. And he's frustrated, but he goes and he waxes all the cars. And once again, it's midnight, and he's going home, and he's starting to get heavy-hearted because he feels like he's being taken advantage of. And he feels like he's being duped. So he reports the next day, and now he's got to pay a fence. And the fence is like a mile long. And he's starting to get, it's giving way to anger. And then finally, the final day comes, and he's got to paint an entire house. And to make it worse, Mr. Miyagi goes fishing and leaves him there to paint the house. So when Mr. Miyagi finally comes home, Daniel blows up at him. And basically, you know, you're taking advantage of me. I'm free labor. You know, my arms hurt. I'm tired. I'm exhausted. I'm at the end of my rope. And then all of a sudden, Mr. Miyagi starts like winging kicks and punches, and he's sanding the floor, and he's waxing the fence, and he's painting the fence. And he realizes in that moment that the whole time he was being trained. He was being taught how to defend himself. But he wasn't paying attention to that lesson. Now, thankfully, Mr. Miyagi showed up, because Daniel probably wouldn't have come back the next day. But guess what? It's a two-sided coin. God will dupe us too. How many times do we think that, oh God, we've got to do this again? And you realize that it's what God wants for us, and it works out better for us. That we are being trained by Mr. Miyagi. We see the bad things in the world, and it's our job to step up and maybe pay for that girl's groceries. Or step up and, you know, I was fortunate when I was a young man that I was in a grocery store line. I was probably 10 years old. And the person in front of me was going through a similar situation. This is why I'm upset with myself. A similar situation where they're scrounging for change and they don't have enough for what they got. And they're starting to put things back. And as she's starting to put something back, the person that was standing directly in front of me dropped the $50 bill on the ground and then tapped the woman on the shoulder and said, ma'am, you dropped your money. And the lady started to say, it's not mine. And that person said, well, It's yours now. It's under your foot. Never said, I'll give you the money. I'll take the credit. I'll take the praise. But I always find it fascinating, and I think about it every now and then, if the person that did that even realized that I was watching. You know, and sometimes as morbid as this might sound, sometimes I can't wait to get to heaven to see some of those people and just be like, I was watching. I saw you do that. Thank you. Because I like to think that I've done things at times. You know, it's called practicing our faith. You know, sometimes I get disheartened because I'll be watching Discovery Channel and I'll see a show about like the Shroud of Turin, or I'll see a show about, you know, the Veil of Veronica, or these like artifacts from the time of Christ, and thousands of people show up to a weeping wall and things like that. I think they're missing the point. Even though the woman that was bleeding for 12 years in the Bible said, you know, she reached out, she touched Jesus' robe, and she was healing. And Jesus didn't say, hey, my magic robe just healed you. Jesus said, your faith healed you. So that's why, once again, it comes about, you know, we need to pay attention to what's the most important thing. You know, when I first became a Christian, I was diving into every chat room on the internet, trying just to find as much Christ as I can get into my life. And I remember, like, the very first room I went into, it was like a free-for-all with, like, six people involved, arguing over whether the nails were in the palm of his hand or in his wrist. And it's like, you've completely missed the point if that's what's important to you. That's not the whole point of why you went to the cross. I mean, we can debate that all day long. It doesn't mean anything. More importantly, too, folks, when we speak and when we fellowship, we need to believe what we are saying, not just say it. It's one thing to say this, I believe it, but you have to really believe it in here, not here, in here. You know, God gave us two great gifts. God gave us a brain and God gave us a heart. And it's a real simple equation when navigating what's right and what's wrong. If these two are not in agreement, it's probably something wrong. It's probably not good. It's probably not for the kingdom of God. Because our heart sometimes tells us to do one thing. Oh, I love that girl so much. Even though she may be riddled with problems, even though she may be taking you down the wrong road, this is still telling you, yes, it feels nice. But this is telling you, no. Sometimes this is telling you it's the right thing to do. Maybe I want to, to do something shady to make more money, even though the money will help my family, but not a good idea. And this is telling you, this is saying, yes, yes, do it. And this is saying, no, don't. Generally, if they're both in agreement, you're going to be just okay. You're going to be just fine. That's why God put them there. Praying is imperative. Not praying every day, praying all day. If you're driving to work and you see a car accident, what good does your prayer do if you wait 7 hours? Why can't you just simply say, Lord, be with those people? Why can't you simply say, Lord, do this? I used to work in a hospital as a security guard, and I used to have to patrol the hospital. And I think I would pray the entire patrol, because you're going into places where people are sick, hurting. Sometimes they're dementiated if you're in that part of the hospital. And sometimes you'd actually hear other people praying, you know, come take me, because they're in pain and things like that. And my coworkers used to giggle because I would do my regular patrol, and then I would go all the way back across the hospital to labor and delivery and do that last. Anybody know why I would do that last? It's the one happy place in the hospital. And I always wanted to end my prayers at the happy place. Believe what you say in here. My son comes home sometimes, and he tells me things that his friend told him. You know, somebody has $1,800 billion trillion dollars. You know, the guy's driving a rusty old pickup truck. I generally don't take his word for it. But we do that. We do that when we put the news on TV. We do that. We, whether we want to accept it or not, media, social media, your friends, everyone has their own opinion. And everybody's presenting their opinion. It's up to us to sort of sift through and say, wait, stop, breathe. Oh, okay. That's what it means. Or go and look at it. You know, I went to the social justice meeting here at the church. And I didn't think it was going to be my cup of tea, to be just 100% honest with you. And I went in because I don't believe that I can argue against things that I know nothing about. So I wanted to go and I wanted to see. And it turned out to be, you know, a very, very fruitful thing. And I'm not going to pass an opinion on anything political. That's not what this is for, being up here. But I do want to say this. They were talking about Dreamers and DACA, and Dreamer this and Dreamer that. And I had my own stance. But as people were talking, I came to the realization that I'm making a judgment on something, and I didn't even know what a dreamer was defined as. So I went and I researched. So now I feel like I have my own opinion in here, and that's that. But because we're scared, you know, people believe two things. They believe things that they want to be true, and then they believe things that they're afraid of true. It's all a sham. It's all a dupe. It's only a matter of what you know to be right. You know, not what you think, you know what to be right with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In closing, we can keep ourselves aware, attuned, and on the right path by doing three things. One, pray, not just daily, but constantly. Two, read this for yourselves. Bible studies, concordances, all of those things are good. Don't misconstrue what I'm saying. They're all good. But everybody should set aside time to read this for yourself. And you decide what it means. Because you might find out you're holding a book of invertebrates if you're not careful. Lastly, practice your faith. Sometimes your actions are far more powerful than your words, because I can tell you this, there have been plenty of good men that have said good things to me and have given me good advice, and a good portion of that has been long ago forgotten. But I've never forgotten that woman that dropped the $50 bill. Practice your faith. Work at it. Because if you don't, you'll be a jerk. And I don't mean to sound harsh, but it's the truth. When you are not actively trying to be a good person, you don't care. And that's never a good thing. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, I hope my words were pleasing to your mouth. Your will, not my own. I ask your love to be abound in each and every one of us. I ask that we leave this place better than when we found it. I ask you that as we meet people along the way, and as we carry your word to different places, that we leave those places better than we arrived. I ask you to make us available to those who may not know you yet, to those who may not realize that you love them yet. Make us available.